When Sebastian Junger appeared on the stage of Tucker Theater on the MTSU campus, he carried the credentials of an award-winning journalist who for more than 20 years has reported from all parts of the globe, Sierra Leone, Liberia, the Middle East, and Bosnia. But for J-School journalist, his ladder of success, from cultural anthropology to climbing trees as a tree trimmer to simply heading overseas, is more than unorthodox.
Sarajevo was besieged. It was 1993. And I wound up there with a bunch of other freelancers I'd made friends with, three or four other guys, and I gradually figured it out. And I started filing radio reports. I mean, I was at the very bottom of the media food chain.
Serb paramilitary groups had surrounded Sarajevo and other cities and were shelling them, and it was horrible. It was like Misrata. It was the Misrata of the early 90s. And I just went there, and I thought, maybe if I just go to a war zone, I'll learn how to be a war reporter. And rather than learning how to be a war reporter than going to war, that maybe works the other way around. And it does.
Bosnia gave Junger what he says was his first intoxicating sense that he was doing something important that had real meaning and consequence beyond his life. But for sheer terror, Junger says Liberia was the worst. He was accused of being a spy by the Taylor regime, and the rebels were attacking the city. Colleague Tim Hetherington, whom he didn't know at the time, was with the rebels. Junger was in the city in hiding from the Taylor government.
And it was just horrendous. And I had PTSD after that, like, unbelievable.
He managed to secure magazine assignments covering wars. In 1996, he traveled to Afghanistan to write about the Civil War and the Al-Qaeda training camps in the Tora Bora Mountains.
And I remember being in Jalalabad the summer of 96, and an Afghan pointed out to the mountains and he said, there's foreigners out there, there's Arabs up there in those mountains, and they'll kill us if we go up there, and we're Afghan and we can't even go there. They're foreigners and they're training for something, and this is wrong.
Junger says 9/11 brought memories of that conversation to the front of his consciousness. He returned to Afghanistan in 2000 to cover the leader of the Northern Alliance, a coalition of fighters who were battling the Taliban and Al-Qaeda. The Taliban had taken over Afghanistan just after he left in 96.
I'd been in a number of wars, but I'd never quite seen war like this. I mean, but the Taliban were dug into entrenched positions on this ridge, and from that ridge they could shell Massoud's only supply route out to Tajikistan, where he got all his supplies from. And winter was coming on, and he had to shut down that position. You know, they hated the Taliban, and I remember getting hugged on the streets of Kabul by Afghans when they found out that I was an American. They would come up to me and literally thank me for what my country had done for them in kicking out the Taliban.
Junger thinks that achievement was squandered by the lack of manpower, resources, and neglect following the invasion of Iraq in 2003.
Really a city liberated. I mean, it was amazing. And, you know, we kind of squandered that. I mean, you know, like, the short version, in my opinion, is we went off to Iraq and completely forgot Afghanistan. I think we left 15,000 soldiers there. There's 40,000 cops in New York City. Like, it wasn't going to work.
Had we devoted the amount of national energy we put into Iraq, into Afghanistan, I literally don't think there'd be a war there right now.
As the war dragged on, Junger sought to be embedded with American soldiers to see the war through their eyes. The stories were first told in a series of magazine articles for Vanity Fair.
With Restrepo and with my book War, what I wanted to do, what Tim and I wanted to do with the movie, was just communicate for civilians what it feels like to be a soldier.
I wound up with battle company of the 173rd Airborne. I was in the Korangal Valley of eastern Afghanistan, 6 mile long valley, 150 men of battle company were there. And while I was there for a while, a fifth of all the combat in all of Afghanistan, a fifth of all the combat being for 70,000 NATO troops, a fifth of it was happening inside the Korangal.
And I was with them for 2 weeks in Zabul in December 05 and just was blown away by the quality of the men. It was all men. The quality of the men, the dedication, the toughness, just the everything. I just couldn't believe it. And if battle company goes back to Afghanistan, I want to follow them for a year, a platoon for a year, for as much of a year as I can.
In 2007, Junger spent most of his time at an outpost called Restrepo, a 20-man position of essentially a platoon intercepting Taliban fighters. As he put it, No internet, no phones, no running water, no way to bathe for 3 to 4 weeks at a time.
No alcohol, no television, no women, no nothing that young men like. None of it was out there. And those guys were out there for a year.
In 2001, Junger brought out the book War, a full-length version of the story of being embedded for weeks with young men who faced constant enemy fire in the Korangal Valley, just north of Khyber Pass.
I mean, Restrepo was a 20-man position, and the enemy, had they been willing to lose enough fighters, they could have overrun it. I mean, they could have killed just about everybody up there. We all knew that.
For the documentary Restrepo, Junger and Hetherington wanted to avoid politics and focus more on the experiences of soldiers in combat.
And soldiers in combat, at least the ones I know, are completely uninterested in the politics of all this. I mean, they're just not. You know, it's like cops aren't that interested in, you know, the socioeconomic realities that lead to high crime. You know?
They were in something like 400 firefights during their year. They were in an enormous amount of combat. Everyone out there was almost killed, including me and my colleague Tim Hetherington.
Junger recalls seeing soldiers walking around with holes in their uniforms from close rounds passing through the fabric, but not their flesh.
I was leaning against some sandbags one morning, not much was going on, and to understand the story, you have to understand how bullets work a little bit. They go a lot faster than sound, so if someone shoots at you from a few hundred meters, the bullets go by you before the sound of the gunfire reaches you. And bullets, when they go by you, they're pretty subtle. I mean, the sound they make is pretty subtle. It's a kind of strange snapping sound. And literally, if someone shoots at you from a distance, the first thing that goes through your mind is a question. Like, are we getting shot at? Like, is that, you know, everyone kind of looks at each other in puzzlement, and then a half a second later, you hear the gunfire. Yes, you're getting shot at. And so I was leaning against sandbags, and not much was going on, and some dirt flew into the side of my face. I just had the time to think, what the hell was that? And I heard the gunfire, and it was the first round of the first burst of an hour-long firefight.
Junger says the bullet impacted the sandbags inches from his head. Later, he thought about the math and the angle of deviation at 400 meters for something traveling 2,000 miles an hour, missing by 3 inches.
You realize after a few incidents like that, and we all had a few incidents like that, you realize that it's all random. And that's a real challenge to any sense that God's going to help you, or that being a good person will help you, or that, you know, you have a wife and kids back home you need to return to, or you're a good soldier, or whatever you might think is going to help you. It really challenges that idea.
Junger says it can easily give one an existential crisis.
You know, like, I'm alive because, you know, there was a gust of wind that deflected the bullet by an inch. Like, that's what this is about? That's all the meaning life has? I don't know the answer, but I know that the question was painful to me. I can't imagine what that question feels like to a 20-year-old, and they all dealt with it.
Cortez.
I went over there thinking that there wasn't going to be much combat. And I'd never heard of the Korangal Valley. The soldiers, I learned later when I got to know them, they all thought there wasn't going to be much combat. They're combat infantry. So if they think there's not going to be much combat and they're going to be sitting around for a year, they're not particularly psyched.
Junger says some live to regret the false disappointment that nothing would be going on. Junger initially sought to write about counterinsurgency.
So I wanted to sort of write about how counterinsurgency works, you know, because it usually doesn't work. And guerrilla wars over the centuries, over the millennia, usually work against empires. Not always, but, you know, eventually they kind of work. And I was sort of interested in how is it that a group of an outgunned, outnumbered group of lightly armed fighters can fight an empire to a standstill. And then I got there, and there was an enormous amount of combat, and I became really interested in how the men reacted to it and how I reacted to it. I mean, we were on a long patrol coming down a hill, and really spread out, and we got hit from a few hundred yards away, and they were just, it was all coming in on me and Tim, I don't know why. And we were behind these two. I was trying to hide behind a sapling that was literally the width of a beer can, and And I was watching rounds hit the, I was down on the ground and trying to make myself the width of a beer can. And leaves were fluttering down on our heads because the bullets were clipping the leaves over our head. And I'm like simultaneously trying to get the video camera up and running and watching bullets hit the ground behind my feet. And I was like, if the mortars don't come in soon and start hitting that position, we're dead. Like, those bullets are going to find us in the next minute or so.
The friendly mortars did arrive, and they made it out without being hit.
I'd already been in enough combat to know that nobody takes notes during a firefight. Like, you look stupid, you feel stupid, and you can't read your handwriting afterwards. I mean, So what I started doing was I would bring, starting in Liberia in 2003, I started bringing video cameras, so at least I could shoot B-roll. During the times that were so fluid and dangerous that I wouldn't reasonably take notes.
Junger says videotaping action became a form of note-taking, and he was able to give video to the networks to supplement interviews of his eyewitness reports.
So when I had this grand plan of following a platoon, I thought, okay, I might as well just shoot a ton of video, and maybe I can make a documentary afterwards. So I didn't see it as, I saw it as adding to the project and enhancing what I was doing as a writer. I didn't see it as either or. I thought, well, this covers the moments where I won't be writing things. And then if I just take care to shoot some more stuff, some establishing shots and some cutaways and some interviews with guys, you know, whatever, then maybe I can make a documentary.
Junger says he found people, including himself, very adaptable to challenging situations. Reporters in such environments must be willing to suck it up, he stresses, as his late friend Tim Hetherington after breaking his leg.
You don't have the right to make personal choices when 30 people are depending on you for their safety. And the medic said, look, there's nothing, we can't get in a medevac, and we sure as hell can't carry you, you're 6'4". You're just gonna have to walk on it. And he did. Without exception, in my experience, the emotional consequences of covering something come later. They never come in the moment.
Like dealing with the sudden loss of a comrade.
I'm sure emotionally there were all kinds of consequences. I mean, if you delay an emotional reaction to something, it comes back, you know, sevenfold later. But later is a time of greater safety when you could actually sort of deal with it. And in those moments, as a soldier and as a journalist, you just don't react. And a couple of times I've sort of like broken down emotionally because I was so upset, but there were never moments of danger. There were moments of, you know, just sorrow. But Tim was like, wow, I came off that mountaintop and I filmed the grief of some soldiers who were clustered around their dead friends. And I filmed that. And he was tremendously ashamed of it. And I'm glad he filmed it. They're glad he filmed it. He's glad he filmed it. But that doesn't mean that there aren't some complicated emotions connected to it. And, you know, I kept seeing these incredible acts of courage under fire. And I had to summon my own form of courage because, I just understood that if I kind of lost it psychologically out there, I was going to endanger other people. And, you know, my whole life, either doing tree work or war reporting, dealing with your fear is like the central task you have to take care of. I'm in a group, other people are depending on me to, like, not lose it in the middle of a firefight or not fall out physically on a hard patrol. I was twice the age of all those guys, and I would reassure myself, I'm like twice the age, but I'm carrying half the weight. Like, that was the thing I did in my head. I wanted to understand the emotional experience of combat, and I divided it into three sections: fear, killing, and love. Like, those are the three primary kind of emotional food groups of the combat experience. So what evolved was, okay, I want to get as deeply inside the soldier's experience as possible, inside their subjectivity, inside their emotional world, inside my emotional world. And I wanted to understand, you know, finally, I wanted to understand how courage worked. Because on the face of it, in sort of Darwinian terms, it doesn't make much sense. I mean, at its most extreme, you're 21 years old, you don't have kids, you throw yourself on a hand grenade, to save your buddies, your DNA ends right there. So I became interested in that sort of conundrum, like, okay, if courage tends to get people killed, why does it happen? And the book, I mean, I don't say it explicitly, but the sort of subtext of the book was trying to understand why young men will do this for each other. Not for a cause, not for their country, not for all the stuff that gets them to sign up, but out there on the battlefield, they're doing it for each other.
Junger likens it to self-sacrifice a parent has for a child. What parent, he says, wouldn't risk their lives to save their kid? No one would call it bravery, he says. They would say, that's parenthood.
Well, soldiers as well, they hate calling that bravery. They're like, well, that's just being a soldier. If you don't risk your life to save your buddy, you're not a soldier. Forget about it. For them, the term courageous soldier is, like, redundant. You can be a soldier, you can be a coward. But courageous soldier is completely redundant. It's like if you don't have a certain amount of courage on the battlefield, you're just not a soldier.
We flew in. Remarkably, Junger says only one of the soldiers chose to leave the Army when his enlistment was up. The rest stayed in for another deployment. Like others, Junger naturally wanted to know more about the soldier's post-war experience.
First question for Brendan was, so Brendan, is there anything at all that you miss about being out there, anything at all? And he looked at her without a trace of irony, and he said, ma'am, I miss almost all of it.
Junger sought to explain what a soldier meant when he missed combat and war. Why, he said, would any sane person miss it?
What they're actually missing isn't, you know, adrenaline and killing and, you know, whatever, all the obvious stuff. What they're really missing is brotherhood. They're missing a sense of utility and connection and usefulness in a small group of people that they care about and are willing to die for.
Junger says when soldiers come back to society, the sense of meaning is less clear. Not sure of their purpose, their role, what society wants from them, suddenly Junger says the tribe goes from a handful of comrades to millions.
That's almost sort of agonizing to soldiers.
What they miss is not killing, they miss brotherhood and a sense of utility in a small group.
Junger suggests the platoon and combat experience exist on an ancient level, much like small connected groups in society. For soldiers, identity doesn't matter as much as being a good soldier, Junger contends. If you're willing to risk your life or the lives of your brothers, that's the bottom line, courage.
You know, you don't need to be tall to be brave. You don't need to be rich. You don't need to be, no one's born brave. You can't buy it. Like, there's no way to achieve that except by deciding that the lives of people you care about are more important to you than your own life.
We all have access to being brave and compassionate, Junger suggests. It's entirely on us, he says, whether we are or not.
And there are very, very brave people who are in prison, and there are cowards who are kings.
It also takes courage to cover war and conflict. According to the Committee to Protect Journalists, more than 40 media workers were killed in 2011 while reporting around the globe. One of them was Junger's good friend and co-director, Tim Hetherington. A few weeks after attending the Oscars, the Arab Spring was flowering in the Middle East. Tim went to Libya to report on the civil war there.
And on April 20, he was hit by a mortar in the town of Misrata, hit in the groin with shrapnel, bleeding very heavily. Another journalist named Guillermo Cervera, a Spanish photographer, put him in the back of a pickup truck, and they were driving like crazy to the hospital in Misrata, and Tim bled out in the back of the truck and he died. Not the first guy that I've known who was killed, not the first journalist I've known who was killed, but the first one I was really close to. And it was a terrible, as you can imagine, a terrible day for me.
After Tim's tragic death, a Vietnam vet wrote Junger telling him that he and Hetherington had done a great job of coming close to understanding the real truth about war, but not quite all the way.
The core truth about war is that you're guaranteed to lose your brothers. And he said, you know, until now, in some ways you guys didn't understand the first thing about war. And now you've lost a brother, and Sebastian, you understand everything you need to know about it. That's what war is.
Junger admits the Vietnam vet was absolutely right. Among other things, it made him decide he didn't want to inflict that pain on anybody else.
I'm 50. I've been doing this for a while. I've had too many close calls. And right then and there, I just decided, you know, I'm out. I'm going to keep foreign reporting. I'm going to keep doing what I love to do. But no more pickup trucks filled with rebels on front lines. That's over with.
I'm actually not going to cover combat anymore. After Tim got killed, it was losing Tim was so hard, you know, like I didn't know how bad grief was. Like I'd never lost someone who was, you know, my age or younger than me even. And I mean, you know, your grandfather dies and it kind of makes sense, but you know, someone who dies at, you know, in the middle of their life, like I never had that experience. I was really stunned by how painful it was. And I just sort of felt like, you know, I'm 50, like I don't want to do that to the people I care about. Like, there is a point where you're too old to be hurting people anymore, you know? And I'm like, I'm 50, I just don't want to do that. And
Junger had to figure out how he was going to continue in journalism and feel equally intense and meaningful covering issues that aren't war.
I'm figuring it out. And it's funny, like I made that decision literally the day Tim died, and I've never regretted it. I mean, I don't miss it at all. I'm actually quite relieved to not have to go out and do that stuff anymore.
Even so, Junger believes the arguments between the left and the right about the inherent qualities of war, whether war is good or bad, are simply false arguments.
The confusing and intriguing thing about war is that the good and the bad of it coexist, and you have to understand them and both and integrate them, or you're missing what war is. I mean, war is a lot of things. In fact, war is just about everything, and you can't, there isn't any one single truth about war that excludes all the other truths. It's everything. It's good, it's bad, it's beautiful, it's ugly, it's, you know, it whatever, it saves you, it kills you, I mean, whatever. I mean, anything you want to say, any cliche, it's all true.